have a guest, an expert on psychiatric drugs. Her name is Kelly O'Mara. She is the author of the book called Psyched Out. She's an investigative journalist, and she was actually one of the first to expose the link between school shootings and psychiatric drugs in her 1999 cover story, Guns and Doses. And she writes for Washington Times and Insight Magazine and other publications. She joins us now by phone. Thank you, Kelly, and welcome to the show.
It's a pleasure to be with you, Mike.
It's great to have you on. I hope you are buckled in and ready for an interesting hour of comments and calls.
Yeah, it should be interesting.
Well, let's start from the top. Tell us, what do you know through your investigations and research? What is your knowledge of the real link between psychiatric drugs and school shooters?
Well, as you just said, I was actually the first national reporter to put out a cover story on this, Guns and Doses, and it was right after Columbine. And basically what I showed was, I think it was the last 10 out of 13 shooters at that time had been on psychiatric drugs or were coming off of them, and that Eric Harris was on a mind-altering drug, a psychiatric mind-altering drug, at the time of the shooting. So since then, you know, I can't believe it's been, what, 15 years. We're still dealing with this as far as I'm concerned. And the problem is that nobody wants to address this connection.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? The mainstream media, of course, is largely funded by the drug companies and their psychiatric drugs. So it seems to be unwilling to really cover this story. Have you seen resistance in the media to your covering of it? For example, have you ever pitched stories to mainstream magazines and they said, no way, we won't cover this because of our advertisers?
They never tell you it's because of advertisers, no.
What do they say?
Well, they just turn it down.
It's randomly deleted.
Yeah, that's the life of a journalist, though.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, I look at it, and I've done enough research. I wrote a book about it. The connection is definitely there. I don't understand, especially with the recent event in Newtown, why the public still is not told whether these people are on psychiatric drugs. I think in today's world, with the millions of people in the United States alone who take psychiatric drugs, I think it's odd, to say the least, that that's not one of the first things that the law enforcement or investigators try to find out.
Well, no, what happens after these shootings is immediately the mainstream media and the White House begin to try to shape the story. And they try to shape it to, for example, to say, oh, it was an AR-15 Bushmaster, even though that was actually left in the guy's car. It wasn't even brought into the school. We just learned that, you know, that's a fact that they won't talk about. And then when neighbors say, oh, yeah, the kid was on psychiatric drugs and he was seeing a psychiatrist, that then starts to get muzzled in the press. They don't want that to come out. So we see this shaping of the story to take away the blame from psychiatric drugs and place the blame on a firearm, a specific brand of gun.
Well, I do believe that they shaped the story, obviously. I mean, we all watched it over the weekend after Newtown, and we saw the talk shows and how it was being shaped. The thing is, that this kid, and I hate to even call him a kid, he was a young man. He was 20 years old. This was not a child, okay, at least not physically, maybe mentally. And we know that he had some psychiatric issues. We know this. I mean, everyone has pretty much said it. To what extent, that's the question. When was he diagnosed? What was he diagnosed with? How many drugs has he been given over his short life?
And who is his psychiatrist?
And who is his psychiatrist? Or was it even a psychiatrist? Was it just a regular MD? Because, you know, in today's world, most of the drugging, most of the diagnosing is going on by your family doctor, not a psychiatrist, which is even more bizarre when you start to think about it. Because if there is a specialty of psychiatry, which I'm sure we can get into a very long conversation about that, you know, these are regular doctors who may spend 5 or 10 minutes talking to you and your child. And, you know, they deduce that, oh, it could be ADD, it could be ADHD, oh, they're depressed. I mean, you know, you go through the checklist from the DSM and, you know, hand them a drug. That's really where we're at in today's world.
Let me read some of the statistics from the graphic that you have provided us today. Go ahead and put that back on screen if you could, guys, just to show. These are some of the side effects that are documented in clinical studies and published in peer-reviewed medical journals. The side effects of these antidepressants and psychotropic drugs, they include violence, aggression, homicidal ideation, which means imagining killing people, psychosis, hostility, and mania. And I know that's a shortened version of the list, Kelly.
Right. Oh, totally a shortened list, but those are the most important things to look at. I mean, when you look at the FDA and they approve the psychiatric drugs, the SSRIs, the antidepressants, suicidality, homicidality, mania, psychosis, you know, these are the things that, you know, people must be saying themselves, oh, it won't happen to me. I'm not one of the 4% of the clinical trials. 4% of the clinical trials, people experienced those adverse reactions. Well, unfortunately, those people are walking around us today. They are among us.
Well, that's almost 1 in 20 people. It's 1 in 25.
Yeah.
That's a large, I mean, yeah, in a population of what, tens of millions of people being put on these drugs, you're going to have, you know, many thousands of homicidal drugged up maniacs.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, what's so sad is that, you know, these are regular people who went to their doctor who, you know, I think legitimately were, you know, possibly depressed and whatever. They've been put on these drugs and I don't know, do they all go home and read about the possible adverse side effects? Because these are very, very serious drugs. They're not drugs to be played with, okay?
Well, but their doctors tell them they're perfectly safe. You need this. This will help you. Like a caller that we just had said that when he went into the addiction treatment center, they practically demanded that he go on Zoloft.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, because, you know, gee, someone who's already has a chemical addiction problem, I guess they need other chemicals prescribed by Big Pharma. That seems to be the what's going on out there. But let me read you this. This is bizarre, and I want your comments on this, Kelly, and then okay. I do want to take some calls for you as well. Here's some news out of ABC News. In a Western Australia mental hospital, the wrong man was grabbed by police on the street, an innocent man, because he was mistaken for an escaped psychiatric patient. They then grabbed the man, stuffed him back into the psychiatric hospital, and drugged him up with a powerful antipsychotic schizophrenia drug. And the only reason they realized their mistake was because the drug caused a massive allergic reaction and they had to rush him to the emergency room. They realized this is the wrong guy. So now they can just grab you off the street, forcibly drug you, and damage your brain with these chemicals, even though you're completely innocent.
This was in Australia?
Yeah, this was in Australia.
Wow.
Yeah, it's right. It's on ABC News. It's called Wrong Man Drugged After Psychiatric Hospital Mistake. From December 26th.
Wow.
Yeah. So, well, I mean, I guess if we just match going, a description, I mean, now.
Pardon me?
I was just saying, if we match a description of a psych ward patient now, we can be arrested and drugged. Your comments.
Well, I mean, I'm not sure. Well, you know, the Marine who wrote something on Facebook.
Raub, yeah. Brandon Raub.
Yeah, he had something sort of similar happen to him here. I don't know that we're to that point in this country yet, and maybe it's because so many people voluntarily go to the doctor to get these drugs. I don't know. You know what I mean? What bothers me is that people don't understand the process. And when I wrote my book, that was really the whole point of writing my book was informed consent. I don't think people understand that these diagnoses, these psychiatric diagnoses, are not based in science. They literally are voted into the DSM.
They make it up. They just invent it with a show of hands. They make it up.
Right.
All right, folks, stay with us. We're going to be back with more from Kelly O'Mara, the author of Psyched Out, How Psychiatry Sells Mental Illness and Pushes Pills That Kill.
sick of the globalist eugenicist control freaks adding poison to your water and laughing as you get sick and die? Start purifying your water with ProPure. My friends, I've done a lot of research, and the best gravity filter out there, bar none, is ProPure. And it's available discounted at InfoWars.com. Its filters are silver impregnated to prevent bacterial growth. There's no priming required. It's NSF 42 certified. Optional fluoride filters can reduce fluoride up to 95%. Easy to set up and use. Doesn't require electricity. Purify water from lakes, streams, ponds, and wells. This filter system leaves in beneficial minerals, which is key. Save money by not buying bottled water and avoid BPA that leaches from the plastic. ProPure is the best gravity-fed filter out there. It's what my family uses. InfoWars.com already has the lowest price on ProPure. But if you add the promo code WATER at checkout, you get an additional 10% off at InfoWars.com. You can also call to order 888-253-3139.
And for this segment and into the next hour, we are continuing our interview with Kelly O'Mara, the author of Psyched Out, How Psychiatry Sells Mental Illness and Pushes Pills That Kill. That book is available on Amazon.com and many other resellers as well. And before we go back to Kelly and take some calls, this news was just handed to me by Aaron Dykes. Paul Craig Roberts has published another excellent story. Paul Craig Roberts is one of my favorite writers, by the way. But this story brings up the very good point that, you know how we played that video in the last hour, that the rifle of Adam Lanza was left in the vehicle and found in the vehicle, and that only four handguns were found actually in the school? As Paul Craig Roberts points out, the school has a security camera and locked doors. They would not have let Adam Lanza into the school if he had been carrying a rifle. The only way they let him in is because he must have been hiding handguns. And then that's how he got in and gained access. Now, even though this rifle apparently now was not used in the shooting, that didn't stop the gun grabbers from screaming about so-called assault weapons, even though a regular semi-auto AR-15 is in no way an assault weapon. You have to have a full auto to be an assault weapon. And the prices on those are like $40,000, and you have to go through an extensive ATF background check, and it can take 6 months to even get that, if you could even find one. So the people who are trying to grab assault rifles, they are confused. They are deranged. They are uninformed. They really do not know anything about the weapons that they are trying to ban. But, of course, there's a psychiatric drug link in with all of these school shootings, it seems, or most of them, maybe not 100%, but very, very high percentage. And Kelly O'Mara is the expert on that, the investigative reporter, and she continues to join us here in this segment and the next. So, Kelly, are you open to taking some calls?
Yeah, Mike, I wanted to just insert something there. This is very interesting, this breaking news that from Paul Craig Roberts. You know, that was one of the first questions I asked the day that it happened was, well, what about the video camera at the school? Every school has video cameras.
Exactly.
In this day and age.
And if he had a rifle, they would have released that video footage already.
But even more so, I remember, and I'm pretty sure anyway, watching the coroner the day give the breakdown as delicately as he could, but I remember him saying these were high-powered shots. So this is very interesting. I'm very interested to see what he has to say about this.
Well, yeah, the coroner may be that's a kind of a general term to say a high powered shot. That could be 9mm plus P rounds. That doesn't mean a rifle round necessarily. And we've seen how the media has gotten their hands on the school videos of every other school shooting because they use that as propaganda to show the kids with the rifles and the guns, but wow, we have no video from this shooting.
Yeah.
Why is that?
The first thing I asked myself when I was watching all this, I thought, well, where's the video?
Yeah. Well, we're looking at it on PrisonPlanet.tv. Viewers are seeing the footage from the Columbine shooting. And I remember not too long ago watching some of the footage from the May 1st, 2001 shooting that was patterned after Columbine. They released that video because that used, I think, some kind of a shotgun and some kind of a, I think an M1A rifle or something. So they released that. But anyway, stay with us, Kelly. Sorry I didn't get much talk in this break, but we'll be right back in just 1 minute or so with more with Kelly O'Mara. Just after the 9/11 staged event, the federal government went around confiscating all the video footage from every source imaginable, but especially all the videos showing the strike on the Pentagon, which the government said was an airplane, but most people have now figured out it was probably a cruise missile of some sort. But we don't know for sure because all the video has been confiscated and never shown to the American public. Why is that? Well, it's because the video shows something that contradicts the government's story. That's why. It's kind of obvious. You have to be a moron not to realize that by now. But now with the Newtown School shooting, this raises the question that we're just getting into. Why haven't they released the video from inside the school to show this shooter with his so-called AR-15 Bushmaster rifle? Now, maybe they will. And if that's the case, then okay, maybe he did use it. But the news reports we're hearing today are that he left it in the car. It wasn't even used in the shooting, and they're not releasing the video. So why wouldn't they release the video, especially as it would further their gun control agenda? Why would they keep it a secret? They've released all the other school shooting videos. In any case, we are continuing with Kelly O'Mara, the author of Psyched Out, who is an expert on psychiatric drugs and the side effects in school shootings. And she continues with us on the phone right now. And Kelly, any additional comments before we start to take calls?
Well, yeah, back to this Newtown, Sandy Hook, you know, the video would be interesting from the standpoint of if he had a rifle, the question would be why did they let him in?
Right.
Number one.
Yeah,
and
come on
two,
in.
If he didn't have a rifle and obviously no guns were visible, you know, to the people seeing the camera, whatever, then did they know him to let him in?
Did they know him?
In other words, they let him, either.
Yeah, they did know him.
Okay, so they let him in, okay?
Yeah, they let him in.
But remember, we went through this whole several days of there's no connection between, you know, him and Sandy Hook. There's no connection between his mother and Sandy Hook. So, I mean, what I'm getting at is we really don't know anything concrete after
right.
all this time. And this is a long time.
No, we only know the things that they want us to know, half of which are lies in any case. But you know,
it's frustrating. It's very frustrating.
Well, yeah, and I'm sure there must be people listening who are saying, well, you know, how dare you try to ask for the video of the shooting? You know, you have to honor the dead children. Well, wait a minute. The gun grabbers aren't honoring the dead children. They're using those dead children to pass their political agenda, their anti-American traitorous agenda. They're not honoring the dead children at all. All we want to know is the truth. We don't need to show the actual children. Those can be mosaicked out of the video. We don't need to show them. What we need to see is, did this shooter actually have a rifle on him, or is that another piece of fiction out of this vast
right.
collage of fiction?
Right, and again, I mean, I think the people have to understand the whole purpose behind doing an investigation of something like this, hopefully, is to make sure it doesn't happen again. So it's important to get all the truth, you know, not just pieces, parts, that they want to give us.
That's right. And they haven't shown us the rifle. They haven't shown us the ballistics reports. They haven't shown us any of the brass from the rifle. They haven't even actually shown us much of anything.
And in fact, I think that the families of the victims obviously would like to have all the truth also. So it's not just
definitely.
It's not just us asking these questions.
Yeah, well, let's go to some calls, all right? And by the way, for those of you who have just joined us, Alex Jones will be here in a few minutes to break some big news at the bottom of this hour. And you don't want to miss that. So stay tuned for that. We're going to go to a quick break, but when we come back, we will go straight to your calls, I promise, including Daniel, Leo, Michael, George, and Roy. Not George Michael, but Michael and George, two separate people. We'll be back with all those callers. right, so here's how it works. Anytime the government wants to ban something, some object, some item, all they have to do is they go into a school, stage a massacre of innocent children, and then they just throw that object on the floor and say that did it. They want to ban slingshots. They can just massacre a bunch of children or plant bombs and then throw a bunch of slingshots on the floor. Or knives. They can go in, slash a bunch of innocent victims, and then just throw some knives on the ground and find a patsy to blame for it and then say, aha, knives killed the children. We have to ban knives. Have to ban swords. Have to ban blowguns. We can have a blowgun massacre in America. I'm not trying to make fun of the massacre. What I'm trying to do is point out the utter, insanely idiotic manipulation that is taking place here. Now, those children's lives should never have been lost, but nor should those in Oklahoma City have been lost, nor should those in Aurora, Colorado have been lost, and they were all lost, I think the evidence clearly shows, by a planned, engineered event with the political purpose of blaming a particular object. That's the way it works in America today. But anyway, we are continuing with calls now for Kelly O'Mara on the issue of psychiatric drugs and the relationship between psych drugs and violent shooters. Are you ready now, Kelly? You ready to take some calls? All right, here we go. Daniel in Washington, thank you for holding. You are on the air with Kelly. Go ahead with your question, please.
Hello, first-time caller. I have a question. I've been doing a lot of research on how this kid's face was looking and all that stuff. I've done some research on bath salts, and bath salts have a chemical reaction with the brain that causes hallucinations. Is there a possibility that that could have had any action with the way that this kid did what he did?
Well, we don't know. There's no official report of what he was on, and by bath salts, you mean the illegal street drug that's nicknamed bath salts. I know you're not actually referring to actual salt that you put in your bath. But, Kelly, what are your comments on that? From the way the shooter looks, he looks pretty psychotic, but, you know, it's hard to judge people just by their facial expression. What do you think?
Well, I think he looks malnutritioned, if anything. Again, we don't know. This is the problem. We don't know what he was on. We don't know what he was diagnosed with. We don't know how long he was on these drugs. We don't know if he was just coming off of them, if his drugs had been upped or had they been reduced. I mean, we don't know. We don't know anything other than we can look at this and go, okay, it seems to fit the pattern of these school shootings.
All right. Good answer. We need more information. Thank you for your call, Daniel. Good question. Let's go to George in Connecticut. George, thank you for calling. You are on the air. Go ahead, sir.
Hi. Thanks a lot. I just wanted to make a few comments that weren't related to the thing, but I wanted to give you some clues. I am from Connecticut, and growing up in Connecticut, Newtown was always the byword for being crazy because they had the largest crazy house there until about 2000. And a neighboring town, only about 15 minutes down the road, was famous for felt hats for about 140 years, and their mascot is known as the Mad Hatter or the Hatters for their teams.
Huh.
So that gives you a clue. Gives you a clue on globalists like to take this theme, including the Batman thing. But the things I really wanted to make comment about. Everybody's talking about a financial collapse. If there's a financial collapse, why would we want to be disarmed when the police can't be everywhere?
Good point.
And the second point is, why don't we have a push for disarming the gangs in the country first? Now, if they can disarm the gangs, we might consider disarming because that's a consideration. And they haven't done such a good job with the drug war for the last 30 years, so I don't know how they're going to do that. So, you know where I'm getting with my point. And the last point I wanted to make.
Well, wait, George, wait, before you move on. I have the solution. I know how to disarm the gangs. You have gang signs that say gun free zone, and you just hang them up in the gang areas, and it works like magic. It's a gang gun free zone sign. That's it. Let's sell them in the InfoWars store. That solves the gang problem. Senator Feinstein, we have your solution, woman. It's the gang gun-free zone sign. Magical powers. I'm sorry. Go ahead, sir.
And the last point, and since they killed about 1,000 people in Australia by confiscating the guns that people didn't want to give up. That has a population of about 22,620,000. And if you multiply that that factor you would get out of that, if you divided 1,000 into that thing and use the same factor and multiplied it times the United States, that would come up with a death of 22,000. I'm sorry, not 22,000. Sorry, my mistake. I was looking at the wrong thing. 13,793 kills, including children, mothers, men, everybody. Now, is that what their goal is? Another maybe 12,000 or so Wacos?
Yeah, very, very good point. But as Alex described yesterday, that is what they want. They do want a shooting war to break out. They want that kind of mass murder in America. That's what it seems to be. But I thank you for your call, and I love it when callers have statistics too and good numbers. Very good analysis there. Kelly, what are your thoughts on what the caller just brought up?
Well, it's interesting. That's all I can say.
What's interesting about it? I mean,
it's a lot of statistics there.
Well, but he's right. He's right. You know, when Australia banned the guns, some people said, we're not giving them up, and those became, you know, shooting wars. So his point really is that, is it just to try to save, to prevent the death of, let's say, 20 children, are you willing to kill 20,000 people in America? And apparently the liberals say, yes, we want to kill all the gun owners. They call for shooting the NRA president. They call for violence. They don't kill if they have to murder 50 million American people as long as they think they can save two children in a school. I say it's not worth killing anybody. Why can't we have peace for all of us? You know, why can't we be independent, liberty-minded, upstanding citizens in a free country and just leave it at that? And, you know, sometimes bad things happen, but that's why we're talking about the psych drugs.
Exactly.
All right. Well, let's go to another caller then, if you're ready for it.
Yeah.
We don't screen these callers, by the way, so it can be anything. It can be absolutely anything. So here we go. Michael in Massachusetts. Michael, you are on the air. Thank you for calling, and what's on your mind?
Hello, I'd like to comment on the medication of children in general.
Yeah, go ahead.
They don't have any free will as to if their parents push something on them. So if I might quickly just interject with like something I wrote in the break.
If it's short and to the point, go for it.
Yeah. The Uncle Sam pharma industry pumps kids on methamphetamine derivatives from elementary school onward. Teachers compel parents to believe the lack of interaction in school is somehow a deficit, whereas a genius might be bored with base mental effort required to repeat what is written in the textbooks.
Well, there you go. Your thoughts, Kelly.
Well, I agree. I agree 100%. Children are forced to take these drugs. I mean, they do not have the right to say no. Okay, their parents can put these their children on these drugs, and often the schools push it. They decide that if your child's not like everybody else, because that's what really they want. They want everybody to be the same. And if your child acts out in any way, then, you know, they call you in, and, you know, you need to take your child to have them looked at. And of course, you know, parents believe doctors, believe the nonsense of the psychiatric diagnosis. And surprisingly to me, in this day, 15 years after Columbine, the parents are still putting their kids on what is the equivalent of cocaine,
Yeah.
ADHD drugs, and it blows my mind.
What about
still doing it,
Kelly? What about the combination of these psych drugs, which we know cause a kind of cognitive detachment from reality, but combining them with these first-person shooter, ultra hyper-realistic video games now, where they are really murder simulators? There's a new game that's just come out. I watched the trailer, horrified. It's called Far Cry 3. And this game is, in my view, a murder simulator. I saw the preview. I haven't played the game, but I saw the preview. When you slice, you sneak up behind an enemy and you slice their neck open with a knife and blood gushes out on screen. Bonus points appear on the screen, like plus 10, plus 15. So the more people you stab and shoot, you get points. How is that impacting these drugged up kids?
Well, you know, look, I don't know how old you are, but when we were kids, we played Army, and we blew up Army men. And today's, I don't think there's a single study that supports
that these video games are contributing to these horrific shooting incidents.
But the difference is when you and I were kids, if we played a game, it was a third-person thing, like little plastic army men in a sandbox. Today, they you're actually sitting, you're controlling the character, seeing through their eyes. You know, it's like a first-person training simulator. Right. And now they're coming out with these VR helmets that are ultra-realistic, total immersion in the simulation.
That's up to, the parents buy these things for their kids, which I don't really understand, but they do. It, just like they put them on the drugs. And you say, what about these cocktail of drugs? That's the newest thing, is kids aren't on one mind-altering drug. They're on several.
Yeah.
And at that point, you're literally changing their normal brain chemicals.
Right.
And that's where you start to get trouble.
Well, Kelly, I want to thank you for joining us today. We only have a minute left. Let me plug your book here. It's called Psyched Out. You can find that on Amazon.com. I know you also contribute to CCHR. Their website is CCHRINT.org. They do great work against psychiatric drugs. I've written some things for them before as well. Anything else you'd like to mention before the segment ends?
Yeah, just if we're talking about these drugs, I would encourage people to learn about the adverse side effects to them. And also, if you're diagnosed or your children are diagnosed with a psychiatric mental illness, research it. Don't just take the doctor's word for it.
All right, well said. Thank you, Kelly O'Mara, for all of your comments and thoughts today. Good information. We'll be right back with more straight ahead. Stay with us.
Visit InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. When you're on the site, you can also tune in 24 hours a day to my daily radio broadcast. There's also a free iPhone app to listen to the syndicated radio show when and where you want.